It's a real massive thing that we reconnect with nature and understand our role with it. We're not separated from nature. We need it. A healthy natural world. It's our life support system, but we have to look after it. There's an eel down there.
It's a good sign, isn't it?
Healthy waterway. Which is an amazing experience to be deep in the forest, listening to the stream in the background, in the pitch black, and then you just get lit up by the glowworms, nature's very own constellation.
Oh, look at the legs.
They jump a lot better than I thought. Let's go and find some geckos. The exciting stuff begins. Kia ora, my name's Nick. I'm one of the ectotherm keepers at Auckland Zoo. And what that means is that I look after all the reptiles, amphibians and fish that we keep at Auckland Zoo. But I also contribute to the conservation projects that we're involved in. So today here we're at the beautiful Mahakirau Estate. The purpose of my visit here is to lend a hand with the Northern Striped Gecko Surveys, trying to piece together a picture of their life history and trying to work out how special they really are. We know they're cryptic. We know they're elusive. We can't save a species unless we truly understand it. And a lot of these species, we will spend our lifetimes trying to understand. Okay, so this is where things get exciting, hopefully. We're gonna start surveying for northern striped geckos just along this stretch on in the forest to see whether we can spot any, fingers crossed. And we're just taking weather parameters. So it measures temperature, relative humidity, the wind speed. We record that every time we start, just so we can correlate that information with success or failures with spotting geckos in the survey. So I've had a maximum of 2 kilometers an hour. Wind speed, temperature is 15.6. Humidity is 88.2. 25 to 11. We're very fortunate to have the relationship that we do with Sarah and the other residents at Mahakirau Forest Estate. We come out for 4 times a year, myself and my colleagues from Auckland Zoo. And this is Sarah's and the residents' home. There is no better people to know the habitat, the animals that live here. We bring a set of skills from what we learn with other ectotherm species. And basically combine those skills so we're unstoppable. The northern striped gecko is a really beautiful gecko. There's only believed to be a striped gecko on offshore islands in the Cook Strait. And a very similar striped gecko was found clinging to a bedroom wall in a house on the Coromandel in 1997. Further investigation and DNA testing actually proved that it was a brand new species. To discover a new species of skink, it blows your mind to think what else is out there, but also that it's evolved to live in the area, the invertebrates it feeds on, how it's affected by predators. And then it can just create a chain reaction of understanding the area, the Coromandel, beautiful, stunning area that we're just scraping the surface on.
Found one.
Hey.
Up in the manuka.
Yeah, right in front of my face.
Awesome.
It's a small one. Well done.
Oh, good eyes. Gecko number one, very exciting. Only a youngster by the looks of it. But first gecko of the night, so it's really, really cool. We're just gonna try and get a photo of it, where we found it.
It looks like it's about to slough its skin. You see how milky it is? You can't really see the detail on it at the moment. So it might come off in my hands a little bit.
When we're trying to take the body measurements and trying to get the dimensions of the gecko, it's really, you've got to be really careful not to damage them anyway. Just putting them in the bag is the safest option. It's much easier for us to manipulate their body into the position without trying to use our fingers. They've only got small lungs, so there's a lot of air in that bag for just a little gecko. So we measure from the tip of the snout to the vent, or where their reproductive organs are, and then we take a measurement from the vent to the end of the tail. If we recapture that gecko, it'll have data on how fast they're growing, how much they're changing. The more information that we can gather from each gecko, the better. So we can plot this data and learn everything we can about them. Yep, that's number one of tonight and number one for me, so that's great.
And we were 10 minutes in.
10 minutes in, that's brilliant. Good start. There's always a magic when you discover a new species. The excitement, but that might melt away slightly when you realize how much work you have to do to find out about the species. How many are there? What are the threats to it? What are these predators? It's all information that some unlucky people like me have to go through and try and find patterns and correlate it all together.
Found it.
Sticking out of the fern fronds.
Looks pretty perfect. Hello.
Hello.
I'm just checking the mugshot that we took before on the catalogue that we've made. And so I've been through all the processed geckos.
It is now.
And this one's not in that catalogue. So this is a new gecko. We just keep finding new ones. It's almost like a fingerprint. The top of their head has very distinguishing marks on them and different colouring as well.
Noticed the trend with the plants the geckos like to be in and around. So we were focusing on certain species of plants that might have a gecko perching in there. The more you do it, the more you get a trained eye for the kind of areas that, I think we use the scientific term, this area looks gecko-y. With the data collection, every time you find one, you log what plant it was on, GPS where it was found, and you start to build this picture of where they like to be. And that's vitally important, that's as a starting point.
You can see on the Garnier grass here that a caterpillar has been munching. And we've just found them starting to pupate. There are two, like right next to each other in two different phases, just starting, so you can still see that it's a forest rennet.
Oh yeah.
Wow.
Forest ringlet is on the top 10 list of species about to go extinct off the planet. They are so extremely rare. There's only about 100 people who've ever seen a butterfly in the wild. I think it's probably less than 10 people who've seen one of these caterpillars in the wild.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you.
It's been great, as usual.
Well, I mean, finding that little baby, that's absolutely that's a highlight. Awesome, yeah. When you see them breeding and surviving, especially this year too, because of the drought, and we were actually worried what's happening to the geckos this summer. Yeah. But to see they did breed still. Mm.
Yeah, it's really warm today, isn't it? Mm.
Welcome to Mahakirau. This is an estate of about 600 hectares, private land. Everything is QE2 covenanted, so we're surrounded pretty much from there all the way around to there. 75% is surrounded by Department of Conservation land. So this is Coromandel Harbour, and that dark ridge line coming down is the end of the Coromandel Peninsula. I love it. This is my forever project. We've got the most extraordinary endangered species living here. What makes us successful is because we actually live in the forest with what we're trying to protect. So it's it gives back just as much as we give to it.
We've recently decided to develop a field base and community hub on one of the sites in Mahakirau. We want it to be a place where we can help train up volunteers, help educate young kids, provide a base where scientific endeavour can be facilitated. We have been working for over 20 years to develop and protect this natural environment, working with partners like DOC and the Waikato Regional Council on a predator control program that has substantially evolved over that period of time. It's a real privilege to be able to live here and being guardians of some quite special endangered species.
You would have seen last night that the geckos, once we discovered them and they were under a little bit of threat, they just freeze. That's unique for New Zealand, that our species have evolved with only birds as predators, and birds hunt by sight. So what they'll do is they'll freeze, and then of course they're perfectly safe. Unless they're moving, they'll be picked off. What happened is we humans brought in mammals which hunt by smell, and they're just sitting ducks. So we've created an extreme problem for our endemic native species. We're pulling out a piece of card with ink in the middle. They've been out now for 3 weeks with both rabbit and peanut butter. And we're going to pull them in and see if we've picked up any possum or rats or mice or something. And change it. You have a look at that one. Yay! It's not a mammal.
Definitely reptilian.
Lots of inverts.
Lots of invert speckles.
Yeah, but it's not the striped gecko.
You can definitely see very clear footprints for what we believe to be skink footprints. If we can ID these footprints that it's a new species of skink on the estate that we haven't yet recorded, but we need to rule out anything like the invasive species of rainbow skink that they haven't had here. So what we'll do is we'll take this card back to the zoo and we'll try and ID from the data we have. So this is one of our minnow traps that we've put out when we arrived. So it's just to see, try and gauge an idea of what species we might be finding in certain areas. So it's another measure of biodiversity. It's just made out of mesh and the entrances as they go in narrow. So it's quite easy for geckos or invertebrates. They're lured in by the scent of the banana and they find their way through the hole. So that's why you've got to check them every day, because it's designed for the animals to struggle to figure out how to get out. Doesn't hurt them in any way. They just want a tasty snack of banana. I'll put this one out personally. This is going to be the winner. We have a beetle. We have two beetles tucked in that crease there. And the banana looks like it's had a little nibble out of it. Okay, so I'm going to release the beetles back into the bush. It might not seem important when we said we were looking for geckos, but just to find a number of beetles in our traps, it gives an indication of a healthy ecosystem. So humans ourselves, we are included in the pyramid of nature and the ecosystem on planet Earth. So without these tiny little insects that live in the leaf litter in the bush, ultimately you wouldn't have us humans. There wouldn't be anything to break down all the waste. There's millions of processes going on under our feet that we can't see. So we need to start at the very bottom, conserving diverse bush, which will accommodate these great insect life. And it does affect us, even though we can't see it, it's vitally important. There it is.
Oh, that's so cool. So in one of the minnow traps that Sarah had, we've caught New Zealand's giant centipede, one of the terrestrial vertebrate predators that shows another good sign it's a healthy ecosystem. And it's going to submerge itself into the leaf litter.
Oh, that was really special. It's my first ever one seeing one. I've heard about them, heard tales about them, but to actually see one, it's really, really special.
We're on the final night of surveying, so we're nearing completion of our little adventure.
Later into the night, we're investigating other areas and we'll probably head towards the stream to see if we can see any geckos hanging out near the stream in the high humidity areas. Again, It's an information gathering mission.
Lead the way.
Thanks. Get us lost. Many might question the effort and the work that goes into understanding a single gecko species. Wildlife in New Zealand and around the world will be given a status to indicate its vulnerability to extinction. The work we're doing out here with the northern striped gecko is basically feeding into that so we can give it a global recognition of the help it needs. Oh, there it is. Munchie's frog. Look how well it blends in. It's just sitting there motionless. Master of camouflage. We've been really lucky tonight and we've managed to spot an Archie's frog. Sarah's just GPS this location. We sort of get an idea and a map of where they're hanging out. Oh my lord, it's humongous. So now the tree's fallen, but it's not the end of the tree. It's just become a different habitat for different creatures. Look at them all. Where to hang out. So it's nice and damp under here and the trees full of hollows and holes and crevices and the wetter are absolutely loving it. There's different ages and sizes and breeding happily under here. And then you've got bracket fungus living under here, breaking the wood, feeding off the wood, breaking it down. So the life cycle continues just in a different way. What I'm picking up is its eyes at the moment. And crystal clear, pollutant-free streams like this is perfect for amphibians. We're lucky enough to see part of the wetter's life cycle, and it's suspended itself upside down underneath that leaf, and it's shedding its exoskeleton, so it's growing into the next stage.
Underneath the
Hello. So this is a juvenile northern striped gecko. We're just about to take its measurements. Even though it seems like an endless task, collecting this data is vitally important, and Auckland Zoo's past work and achievements have shown that. An example would be the endless data collection and life history information has helped us successfully breed and re-release wetapunga to areas that we know that they're going to thrive, because we've collected all that endless data about food plants they like to eat, temperatures, habitat types. We can go into an area and go, this area will be great for wetapunga.
We've been so fortunate to have the partnership with Auckland Zoo. As we've discovered these endangered taonga, we have really needed the support of academic institutions and scientific research to help us understand what is required to protect these really precious creatures.
Yes, end of the final night. It's 2 a.m. But we ended on a high, found another juvenile gecko. I just love being in the forest, especially at night. I mean, if you know where to look, everything's happening. It's a full show. Lift up a leaf, turn a rock. It's all going on. It's all happening around us.
For me, I've been looking through this forest for years already, and during this session, there's still been a first for me, seeing the pupation of the ringlet caterpillar.
Although I've seen plenty of hotch stitches in the wild before, it's always been in the daytime where you've had to lift a rock up to find one. So actually seeing one emerged and sitting out in the stream was a real treat as well.
You see a gecko looking back at you in your torchlight and you're like, yeah, this is why I'm here. It's a great privilege to be out here, but it's also very warming to think that I'm contributing, along with Auckland Zoo, we're all trying to do our bit in trying to save the beautiful planet that is our home.